Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Andriy Shevchenko. On behalf of the team of the Media Center Ukraine, I welcome all the journalists telling the world about our struggle for freedom. Our next guest is Maksym Kozytskyy, the head of the Lviv Regional Military Administration. And Mr. Kozytskyy will tell us about the, will summarize the first 2 months of the Russian invasion for the Lviv region. Pane Maksyme, the floor is yours. Christos Voskres, Christ is risen. Slava Ukraini. I have with me some papers. We'll probably have to deal with some numbers. So, 2 months. For 2 months, Ukraine has been fighting for its independence against Russia. Probably nobody expected us to fight and beat the enemy for 2 months and to hold the line as well and as for as long. But we've done this. Ukraine has broken, thwarted all of Kremlin's plans. We resist, we counterattack, we liberate the temporarily occupied territories. We make plans of renewing and rebuilding the state. We work in the rear and we try to create safe places, including in Lviv. As far as the military, starting from February 24th, over 20 cruise missiles have been taken down by the air defense over Lviv, over the Lviv region, and over 20 drones of the enemy. The rest will probably come from the official bodies. From the start of Russian aggression, we've improved the system, the alert system, and it works perfectly in almost all communities. We have the Shoslatich, something flying chatbot. Please register in it because it's an additional source of information for the air defense. They use it, and we're doing our best to improve the system, and we have the first positive results. So we ask you all to register. As far as the law enforcement, since the time of the martial law, the anti-terrorist staff have checked about 5,000 people about their involvement in subversion tactics and activity. 14 criminal cases have been opened where people have been informed of this, of the being suspected of treason, of state treason, of human trafficking. 39 cyber attacks have been found out and stopped. Over 90 informational resources and pages have been blocked that had been used to spread the propaganda, Russian Federation propaganda about Ukraine. The administration has been provided critical infrastructure. We have 44 Starlink stations from SpaceX to enable us to work in emergencies. The situation on the border, starting from February 24th to to April 19th, we have let almost 2.5 million people through the border. 1.8 million have left Ukraine, and 650,000 people so far have returned. Humanitarian aid. The Lviv administration, together with our partners, have developed a system for the counting of humanitarian aid, which we use to coordinate the work of the administration. The implementation started on March 4th. The first wave of implementation started when the ministry started proposing solutions that had not yet been tested. We already had all of our storehouses accounted, running counting on our storehouses. This system lets us see what we receive from whom, what we have in storage, what has been sent to whom. Access to this information, we can provide access to this information to anybody who is interested, including the governments and presidents who are interested. This decision has been working in 21 regions. It started in Lviv. According to the Lviv Customs Office, the road traffic brought in 135 tons of humanitarian aid into the Lviv region. Of these, 43,000 tons were loads ultimately directed to organizations in the Lviv region. The Lviv regional military administration received about 10% of the aid. All the other communities of the Lviv region also in 10% of the cases. Charity funds, religious organizations, and civil organizations received about 50% of all aid. The hospitals and the emergency service received about 15%. The rest, about 10 to 15%. I would like to mention the funds and the organization that brought the most humanitarian aid. It's the Narodna Samoborona, Caritas, and the Free and the Concerned. They brought in about 5% of all of the goods coming into Lviv, to the Lviv region. From the start of the war, the storehouses, coordinated by the Lviv military administration, distributed about 900,000 tons of humanitarian aid. It was important for us to distribute all of this according to demands of the local administrations from other territories, particularly those in the combat area. The greatest recipients were Kyiv region, Poltava, Kharkiv, and Dnipropetrovsk. Dnipropetrovsk, in the sense that from Dnipropetrovsk it later went to other regions. We took apart some of the humanitarian aid with the office of the president. We've had 71 ambulances sent from the Lviv region to other regions of Ukraine as humanitarian aid. The internally displaced people. Over this time, since the time of the war, the Lviv military administration has provided housing to 300,000 internally displaced people. Of those, 260,000 remain in those places where they were first settled. About 450 internally displaced people remain in the region. At this point, we're doing registration. We have officially registered over the 3 weeks of registration. We've had officially registered 190,000 people, of whom 62,000 are children. Housing. The educational institutions have placed about 25,000 internally displaced people. It's hard to continue normal schooling because of the constant air raids. Even without the air raids, it would be difficult. We're talking about possibly buying apartments that are in new construction. So we've done a database that can be bought, that the builders have available, that could be bought. And we're talking about, right now, we're negotiating about the final price between the government and those contractors and those builders. We have found 156 objects on our part of unfinished construction, dormitories, colleges, sanatoriums, where in theory people could be housed if construction was completed. This would cost about 1.8 billion hryvnia. This would let us place 15,000 people. We have also approved a program of these kinds of first line of objects that could be repaired. This is a regional program. We plan to allocate 50 million hryvnia for this. And together with the communities, this will let us complete 13 objects, and this will let us take people out of schools and provide them better conditions for temporary settlement. We also collect areas where we can start building residences, residential housing. We've had several such in the Lviv region that have full communication. We're waiting for the approval of a state program for the start of the construction of housing for IDPs. Payments and support for IDPs. The Cabinet of Ministers have resolved that the IDPs, adults, shall receive 2,000 hryvnia for support, and children shall receive 3,000 hryvnia. together with the Department of Social Protection and the World Food Program, as well as HCR, these UN organizations, UNHCR, we've had, there have been two resolutions to support IDPs, also by these organizations. The World Food Program provides 2,200 hryvnias per person for food, and 2,200 from UNHCR for IDPs for housing. The program intends to cover 700,000 of, sorry, 500,000. So World Food Program intends to cover 500,000 people, and HCR intends to cover 200,000. In the first month of war, we managed, I would like to thank here the World Food Kitchen and the local restaurant owners and volunteers. We've managed to prepare over 1.3 million meals, hot meals. We've had tons of restaurateurs and makers and suppliers of food. And over the second month of the war, we've prepared 1.5 million meals, hot meals. 1 million of them. This was funded by the World Central Kitchen. 12 educational institutions and sanatoriums have been provided for in the first month. 35 tons of food have been provided for IDPs. Over the second month, the amount of products was 64 tons. The number of children from the Lviv region who were sent for treatment, for medical help abroad, we've had 560 orphans from other regions who are housed in the Lviv region. We've had over 1,000 such orphans, patients with mental health who have been located in the region, over 300 in the Lviv regional hospital. The number of seniors who have been placed in the Lviv region are over 200 people. We've sent almost 300 orphans abroad for medical help and other reasons. We've had 4,200 kids born in the Lviv region since the start of the war, including 368 born to IDPs. Alexander, can we leave some time for questions? Could you just give us a summary so that we switch to questions? Well, we're really involved in relocating businesses. There are 700 applications. Many have applied and are now moving. 45 have also supplied applications and waiting their turn. Over 50 companies have already started work. Over 1,000 new jobs created. Thank you. Questions? Yes. A question about the territorial defense. Could you tell us what sort of provisions do we have for one person? How is this funded? And do you have all of the ammunition? If we take the territorial defense again, it is divided according to the law into three branches. If you take the territorial defense that is part of the military, yeah, the people who are in the front are completely provided for, according to the contracts, as the armed forces of Ukraine. This is no different from the armed forces of Ukraine. Thank you.
TV Satellite TV, George and Governor, thank you very much for your management. This is significant events here to tell us what happens here. Obviously, we are people living in this city here. This residence here is, and people still worry. We hear a lot of attack, missile attack from Russian side, and particularly in supply line. So obviously here it's very good. The shopping's no problem. The food have no problem. I think it's great. So if attack again and the supply line chain has been broken, and do you, as your government, do you have any contingency for plan for keep these cities running? Thank you.
Дякую за запитання. Об'єкти критичної інфраструктури перебувають.
Thank you for this question. Critical infrastructure is constantly being watched, including by branches of the territorial defense. If we take air defense, as I said in the beginning, over 30 flying objects or missiles have been taken down. The air defense is working. We have diversified supply of food and humanitarian aid. We do not envision problems with this. Are you thinking about possible contingency, different paths, different supply lines? Yes, we have diversified supply lines, yes. Thank you. Yes, your question.
And what is your, you think that rail transport here in Lviv suffered any problems in the last few days?
Ви знаєте, що було атака на тягу під...
You know, there was attack on the substation of the railway. The work of the railway has been completely renewed. There are some delays in the train traffic, but the traffic has been renewed and we're working. We're working as normal. We know that previously you started a work group that was supposed to look for Russian companies in Ukraine, Russian-owned companies in Ukraine. Could you tell us, do you have a database working and what is going to happen to them? We have created a work group with the administration. It includes law enforcement, representatives of the law enforcement. We have a list of companies and organizations that we believe that, sorry, that according to the law enforcement bodies are connected to Russian capital. This list is being is developing, so we have sent we were forming these lists and sending them to the security service of Ukraine and to the Council of Security and Defense of Ukraine to make their decision. How many? So far, over 200 companies with possible Russian capital. I wanted to ask you, how have the moods changed in the Lviv region? At the start of the invasion, this part didn't look like an important target for air missile attack strikes. So far, we've had such strikes, and unfortunately, we've had people die here. Over this time, Lviv and the Lviv region have become an important evacuation hub, an important IDP hub, and the region has buried its the first heroes who have fallen both here and in the combat zone. How have the feelings and the moods shifted in these last 2 months? You know, it seems that we sense a unity, there's a sense of unity over the past 2 months. There's a sense of unity between different political forces and different people in their wish to, their desire to help those at the front and those who have relocated here. Of course, we can probably talk of some kind of accumulated tiredness, but my first sense is a sense of unity. A sense of unity in wanting to be useful and in wanting to help. This is what I'm feeling now. What do we know about the searches in Kozak and Sokilniki? We know that there's active... that's a question about... that has to do precisely for Russian capital in the territory of the region. At this point, this information is being prepared and it is being sent to the National Council of Security and Defense. Information is being confirmed. More questions? What would you say the economic component of the Lviv region? How, to what extent have you managed to stabilize this component? What's the financial story? I would like to give some numbers as well. So in terms of the budget, so as of April 27th, we've had 7.225 million hryvnia of taxes, which is 28% more than the same period last year. The regional budget has seen 1.172 million hryvnia, which is again by 30% exceeds the numbers for the same period last year. 350 million hryvnia came to the regional budget, which again exceeds the regional budget statistics for the same period last year. So far, we're overperforming, you could say. Could you summarize what sort of companies have relocated to Lviv, and have there been new companies and new producers that have been added? You know, many companies that have been relocated, they don't want to say that they have moved and where they have moved. Two good instances that have been announced at the Kramatorsk machine building plant and the Bormashina Chernihiv region. Yes, they're also relocated. But over 50 have now started working and over 100 have been relocated. We have a regional program according to which we have decided to co-finance companies that are prepared to relocate. 100,000 hryvnia for relocation, 100,000 hryvnia for renewing or creating 20 jobs, and 500,000 hryvnia to ensure supply for these companies, specifically those who register in the Lviv region. This is coming from the regional budget. Last question: how will Lviv after the victory will be different from the Lviv region before the war? I hope that after the victory, the Lviv region will retain its aura, its spirit, and will remain interesting to people for the same reasons that it was, through its traditions, through its possibilities of development, technology, and the possibility to live freely and safely. And also, but also we'll be different in that we will remember that the Lviv region is part of a great Ukraine. And first foremost in our hearts has to be the thought of the state. Thank you very much, Maksym Kozytskyy, head of the Lviv state.
Good afternoon, everyone. Greetings once again at the Media Center Ukraine. My name is Taras Masalko. And today we have live with us Mr. Yevhen Kramarenko, head of the State Agency of Ukraine on Exclusion Zone Management. Mr. Kramarenko, can you hear us? Good afternoon. Yes, I can hear you. Good afternoon. We know that yesterday you had a visit to the exclusion zone. What is the current situation there? What are your impressions? Yesterday, we hosted Mr. Grossi together with the IAEA delegation yesterday at the exclusion zone. They will be working there for about 3 days. They will be checking the radiation condition and the radiation security in the Chernobyl zone. It's important for an international report. What we've heard from Mr. Grossi is that he's supportive of Ukraine. His stance pivoted after what he saw in the Chernobyl exclusion zone. He is more critical of the Russian invasion of Ukraine. We toured him around those sections of the Chernobyl exclusion zone where the Russians were digging in. They also occupied some of our administrative buildings and a lot of vehicles and other public property were destroyed. In the context of the Chernobyl exclusion zone, there was information that the Russian troops were in the vicinity of the radioactive waste burial sites. Is that true? Or what is the situation with the radioactive waste burial sites? Were not burial sites. It was just a storage place for spent radioactive fuel. We have two sites of this sort. It's true that the Russians were in proximity to these facilities. They were moving their forces back and forth. But fortunately, these sites are intact. They are in satisfactory condition. And we will know more once the IAEA mission is over. What is the destiny of the staff members, all those people that had to continue working in the Chernobyl exclusion zone under occupation? What are the stories that people are sharing? What is their physical and mental condition? The first two shifts that had to continue working under the Russian occupation are already back home. They've shared some stories, and they are saying that at first everything was fine. They didn't really feel the extraordinary dire conditions that they had to work in. So by reflex, they continued working. They continued ensuring the radiation security of Ukraine. But when they were back home, they rethought the situation, and now they are really taken aback by the conditions that they had to work in. They had to sleep at their workplaces. There were restrictions on their movements on the premises of the nuclear power plant, and there were many other limitations on them. Yesterday, at the presidential office, Mr. Zelensky, in the presence of Mr. Grossi, the IAEA director, awarded 37 NPP staff members with medals for courage and valiance for their contribution to the radiation security of Ukraine, because they did have to work under dire conditions, and they did their utmost to remove some of the threats for Ukraine and the international community. What is the likelihood of the Russian repeat invasion of the Chernobyl exclusion zone? And do you think that there's a risk of airstrikes on some of the facilities there, not only nuclear reactors in the Chernobyl zone, but some other nuclear power plants as well, because this is one of the primary concerns of the Ukrainians. The risk is still high, and the consequences will be definitely colossal, even more disastrous than back in 1986. What occurred at the Zaporizhia nuclear power plant, because there was a direct hit on one of the facilities on the premises of the nuclear power plant, that was a precedent that we had never seen in the world before. As for the Chernobyl nuclear power plant, we've heard from the staff that apart from the Russian soldiers being there, some heavy vehicles and artillery systems were deployed there as well. So during the 35 days of the Russian occupation, there were airplanes flying over the Chernobyl exclusion zone, and they fired missiles towards Kyiv. And while turning back, they crossed the sound barrier, and the windows and some other components were even shaking. Because of that, there are some questions from the audience. Andriy Shevchenko, Media Center Ukraine. Do we have more information about those Russians that were deployed in the contaminated area? Maybe you have an update on their health condition, or maybe you can forecast the health implications of their stay in the contaminated area. Maybe we have some information about the amount of radiation that was taken out of the Chernobyl exclusion zone on their vehicles, on their military equipment. So what are the implications for the Russian invaders? Well, first of all, we do understand that the Chernobyl zone, the exclusion zone, is a zone with the higher levels of radiation. This level of radiation was dangerous for everyone even before the war, and it was allowed to spend only a limited amount of time in certain sections of the Chernobyl exclusion zone. That was important from a health perspective. But we detected some trenches and traces of groundwork in hazardous and contaminated areas. The Russian soldiers slept there. They consumed food there. In one of such places, we even found a pen that they used for melting copper wires. I guess they collected some copper for processing. Theoretically, we can make some forecasts about their health consequences. But to obtain more accurate information, there is a need for the medical examination of those people who were engaged in the hostilities on the premises of the Chernobyl nuclear power plant. Some of the sources of ionizing radiation are missing. These sources have even higher levels of radiation. And the occupiers could have obtained radiation burns. Thank you, Mr. Kramarenko. My last question. Has the monitoring system been restored in the Chernobyl zone? This system has been partially restored. Right now, it's operating in manual mode. So basically, we have dedicated staff members that are monitoring the radioactive contamination, and we also take some manual measurements in specific locations. We cannot get to certain locations because a large area is mined, and our military continue identifying explosive ordnance on the premises of the exclusion zone. Thank you. We had Yevhen Kramarenko, head of the State Agency of Ukrainian Exclusion Zone Management, with us. Thank you very much. This is the end of our briefings for today. We will have another special event on Staroznesenska Street. It will be a play in the bomb shelter entitled Mother Via Skype. Everyone is invited. Stay tuned and see you